My name is Dr. Tushar Mehta. I'm from Canada. I did my medical training at University of Toronto, and I did my residency in family medicine, but I've also practiced a lot of addictions medicine, so family addictions, and right now I do mostly emergency medicine, so here I think you call that A&E, yeah, is what you call it. So that's what I do, and I do some international work. I work in India pretty much once a year, and I've done a little bit of work in Kenya and Zimbabwe and stuff like that, just on some sort of medical projects out there. But I'm very, very interested in environmental issues, in ethical issues, and I'm also very interested in plant diet and health. If you don't mind, keep the doors open, please. Yeah, keep them open. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Right on. So that's a lot of the stuff that I do. Now, I'm going to talk about plant diet and nutrition today. It's going to be a general talk about plant diet, nutrition, and specifically like a medical talk, talking about what the medical evidence says, because you can hear and see anything that anybody says. Anybody can have any of their anecdotal experience. They can put something on their website. They can, you know, there's gazillions of websites saying that you should eat this or that or this or that. You know, the paleo diets. Anybody hear about these paleo diets? Big thing in Canada, right? And US CrossFit culture. It's like a bit of a cult. And they're going to say all kinds of things, but essentially, what is the medical evidence for plant diet and health? And that's what we're going to talk about. And we're going to talk about a little bit what constitutes evidence and where medical evidence comes from. So if you find the beginning of the part a little bit technical, you know, hopefully you'll get through that and get to the more interesting stuff for you. But it's important. It's important to know how we do the research and where this information comes from, okay? Just while you're here, just so I can get a sense of the audience, anybody here is vegan? Wow, okay. Vegetarian? Fantastic. Maybe not vegetarian or vegan, but you're thinking about it, you're curious, you're interested. Yeah, a few hands. Good, right? That's what we want. We want people from, you know, every spectrum, right? And what are some of the questions that you might have? What are some questions so that I'll try to keep those questions in mind and emphasize them through the presentation? And if I forget, you're going to remind me. Yes? Interesting. Okay. So Mediterranean diet, is it better than vegan diet? And do we have that information? So I'll try to address that. Okay. I think I might have a slide that addresses that a little bit. And I'd like to talk to you afterwards to get me the reference, because I'd like to find out what reference they were using. There's a newspaper article probably based on some kind of a study that was published, or interpretations of studies. And that's interesting, because there's studies and there's also how we interpret the studies and what those studies are made up of. Yes. Illnesses that can be reversed by going vegan or by a proper vegan diet. Okay, what would they be? Where's the strongest evidence? Yep, any other questions? Yep.
Is there a way not to integrate even B12 or vitamin D?
Is there a way that we can...
integrate B12 and take it from food sources?
Oh, can we get it from only plant sources and not from a supplement? Okay, we'll talk about that as well. I'm going to talk about B12. Good question, yes? Sorry? Right. So we talked about this in a previous presentation. I think you asked me a question, but constipation related stuff, right? Okay. Okay.
Well,
yeah. So maybe what we'll do is we'll talk about that specific thing afterwards. You know, I'll make a general comment about, you know, gut motility, but yeah, and then we'll talk more afterwards. Yes. Yep.
For
newborns and toddlers, children, basically, right? Is it safe in children and pregnant women even,
yeah,
right? Breastfeeding, pregnancy, that kind of thing. Yes. Good. Yep. About what? Paleo diet. Okay. Yep. Yes. Okay. Yeah, I will do that, actually. I have a slide on that. Yes. Stress management in addictions. Okay, maybe that becomes its own topic. That's kind of a big topic, maybe. But you know, there's some stuff about mental health and things like that. People on, you know, psychiatric medications can sometimes have a lot of weight gain depending on the type of medications that they're on, right? So antipsychotic medications, and they get metabolic syndrome, and and certain cases like that. And could that be helpful? And addictions in general. Okay. Yeah. Right, but they're going to be basing that on some kind of a medical article, and we'll look at that article. We'll get you to forward it to me, and then I'm going to try and look at that. Okay, so great. So let's talk. So anybody know this guy? Mike Tyson, right? He's vegan now. This one? So our friend Bill, right? He had really severe heart disease. Doctors told him that he's not going to live very long, and he went vegan for health reasons to reverse a lot of his heart disease. This guy? He might be a bit more tricky. This guy, Dave Scott, has anybody heard of Dave Scott? Iron Man competition, anybody heard of Iron Man? He's the first guy that ever won the Iron Man competition more than once, the World Iron Man competition in Hawaii. You know the World Iron Man, you gotta swim 4 kilometers, then you gotta cycle 180 kilometers, and then you gotta run 42 kilometers, okay? And that's the Iron Man competition. He won the World Iron Man competition 6 times in a row, and he's vegan, right? And some of the best Iron Mans have been vegan as well. All right, so let's talk a little bit. Have anybody met Patrick? Patrick out there, right? He's one of the world's strongest guys, one of the world's, maybe the world's strongest guy in his weight class or something like that. The guy's amazing, and he's got a nice smile. He's a pretty good guy, right? I just talked to him, you know. Jake Shields, some of these, okay, these guys are older now, like they've retired from UFC, but there's a few UFC fighters that were pretty good, and they were very high in their thing, and they were vegan. Serena Williams, of course, people know her. And my friend the elephant is also vegan, right? This is me, let's rock it. Okay, I always give my acknowledgments. I get a lot of information from some of these guys who are doctors and nutritionists and whatnot, and they do a lot of the research. I get to go into their websites and look up all their papers and then choose from them and analyze them as well, and as well as doing my own searches. But these are some of the guys that I learned from. All right, now, The first topic of order is, what is science and what is opinion? That's a big, big deal. When it comes to paleo diet and a lot of things that people will say, what is science and what is opinion? Okay, so we're going to talk about that. And the second part of the talk is going to be about practical information on how you can optimize your vegan diet. Okay, so science is important because it's a way of being objective. Science is not always perfect. It's an ongoing process. All right. And in the case of vegan diet, there's a lot of studies that people don't realize exist. All right. And, and science matters in other ways, too, because the type of things that we eat have an environmental impact. And what about the data that talks about environmental impact? There's a movie called Cowspiracy. Have you ever heard of this movie, Cowspiracy? Okay, fantastic movie, one of the most important movies in the world, okay, that has ever been made. And Cowspiracy, you should definitely see that movie. Because it impacts, you know, the entire planet. And now there's a lot of data that goes behind moving that planet. So one of the things that I like to do is that if I give a talk, you should have access to my data sources. So if you look up my name, Dr. Tushar Mehta, that's my name, Dr. Tushar Mehta, Vegan Diet and Health, YouTube, you'll find my YouTube video. It's going to be a similar talk to this. But on there, you can click and download all of my references. At the same time, I have a file there, Vegan Diet and Food Security. Okay, if you download that one, you'll get all of the references that make up the movie Cowspiracy that they use to get the data for Cowspiracy. It's a lot of United Nations documents and everything like that. You know, it's not like some little group that's organized, you know, getting the data from. They're getting it from the United Nations and so forth. Okay, so let's talk about medical science. Medical science comes in two components. There's science in a test tube that looks at a cell and what happens in a cell and says, hey, if you give this drug, the cell does this, and maybe that's good for a person. Okay, so that's sort of basic science research. But that doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to work in a human being. We may find in a test tube or something like that, a medication may work, but it doesn't really work. We don't really know if it works until we test it in a human. It doesn't matter if we tested an animal. There's lots of medications that we test in an animal, but it doesn't work in a human, and vice versa. It doesn't work in the animal, and it does work in a human. Ultimately, if you give a medication or something, it should work in a human. Science, ultimately, medical science, ultimately, you know, goes through all these basic science trials that go through test tubes and animals and whatever they may be, but ultimately, they must work in a human. So phase four trials are what people do to test drugs in a human being to see if they actually work in people. Okay, so that's the important thing, that any kind of medication has to work, has to work in people, all right? So that's what clinical science is, and that's what we want to get from the type of, evidence that we have for human health and diet. It has to be research that's done in people, okay? Now, this is a great little quote. It says that this Mr. Iyengar practiced yoga all his life, and he died at the age of 96. And Mr. Singh over here drank whiskey all his life and died at the age of 99. And so the moral of the story is that whiskey gives you a 3-year edge over yoga, right? So everybody has some uncle who smoked and drank and did everything and they lived to 100, right? But I'm going to tell you that that doesn't matter. Because what medical science looks at is we want to look at 10,000 people. And we want to look at 5,000 people who smoke and drank and 5,000 people who didn't smoke and drink. And we want to see how many people lived until 100 in the smokers, because, yeah, there'll be a few people who live till 100. And we want to see how many people on the other side who didn't smoke and drink, how many cancers and heart disease did they get, and how many people lived to 100. And that's where statistics comes from. When we give you a blood pressure medication, it doesn't matter if it just lowers your blood pressure. It matters if you lived longer. But you living longer as one person, you may be doing everything wrong, eating junk food and smoking and drinking, but you may live to 100. That doesn't, that's anecdotal evidence. What we need is statistical power to see if it works for a lot of people, okay? Somebody can do everything right and they may just get cancer and die at the age of 40. It happens sometimes, it's tragic. But what percentage of different groups, you compare different groups than what they do, and that's what gives us our science, okay? So clinical science, what medical science is mostly composed of is statistics and percentages. Smoking is a great example, right? Between people who smoked and didn't smoke, and we found eventually that smoking was bad for your health. You had more of certain diseases and you had more of death as well. But we didn't know that. People used to say that smoking was good for you, okay? And there's all kinds of studies on drugs, treatments, diagnoses, and nutrition as well. Okay, there's different kinds of studies, like prospective randomized trials, double-blinded, placebo-controlled, case-controlled, retrospective, epidemiologic, population studies, all kinds of things. Now, I don't want to get into all kinds of those studies, but we do certain types of these studies on with our diet, and that's where we get our information. So it's always done on humans. Bigger studies are usually better. You're comparing different groups, and you have to see if those groups are alike in certain ways. If I compare a group of people who are, let's say, exercising and all this kind of stuff, and I compare a group of people who are not exercising and they drink lots of booze and everything like that, and I test a medication in both of them, and I see that this group lives longer, well, the groups were not same to begin with. They had too many differences between the groups. Of course these guys are going to live longer, but that doesn't mean my medication's better. So you have to see what kind of groups you're comparing with each other when you do a study. Okay, and there has to be enough time. If I gave everybody on this side of the room medication A, and they gave you guys all a placebo, and I waited for one day or one week, and I saw that nobody died in this group and nobody died in this group, then I can say, hey, this medication doesn't work. But maybe I just didn't wait long enough. Maybe I've got to wait 1 year or 5 years or 10 years to see if a medication will have a difference over your lifetime, right? Before I can see if it's protecting you from a heart disease or anything else. Okay, so you have to have enough time. You have to have enough people. Okay, in your study, okay? So the other thing you want to study is you don't want to study just whether somebody's blood pressure goes up and down. That's nice. I can study blood pressure medications and spend millions of dollars. We spend billions of dollars on blood pressure medications and just see if your numbers got better, or a cholesterol medication, your numbers got better. Your cholesterol went down or your cholesterol went up. What really matters is if I give you that medication for 5 years, did you have less heart attacks? Did you die less from heart attacks? Or maybe you had less heart attacks, you died less from heart attacks, but you had more cancers. So what was the overall mortality difference? Giving you this medication versus giving the placebo, did you actually have less death? Because maybe there's less heart attacks, but more cancers or what? We need to know what's going on overall. We need to know about diseases that make a difference, like a heart attack or a stroke that affect your life. And we need to know about death. Those are the studies that matter. So when somebody does a study in a test tube that says that this affects your thyroid, maybe, as what, you know, what they might say, or they did this some study in mice about soy or whatever, that doesn't matter. What matters is what happens in a human practically in real life, okay? So, and what we like to also have is we have like to have studies that compare. People want a standard diet with a semi-vegetarian diet, with fish-eating diet, with a vegetarian diet, with a vegan diet. Those are the spectrum of studies that we'd like to see. Then we can see which group comes out ahead, like the study that you're talking about with the Mediterranean study, okay? So there are two big studies that are going on that actually include vegans. Okay, two very large studies. One is in the UK, actually. There's something called the EPIC, the European Prospective Investigation to Cancer. And the subgroup that is, there's the one group, one of the sites is in the UK. And that group actually, it's back. Hello? Okay. So the subgroup in the UK, sorry, the UK component of that actually contains a lot of vegetarians and vegans. It's too loud all of a sudden. I don't know. Okay, so they're able to study vegetarians, vegans, fish-eating people, and so forth in that subgroup, which has about 40,000-50,000 people in it, and there's maybe about 2,500 vegans in there. So there's enough of them that they can study. And the other one is in the United States, the Seventh-day Adventists. There's a significant group of vegans and vegetarians and fish eaters and standard diet people in there. So that's are two populations where they look and they try to control for things like smoking and socioeconomic factor and alcohol consumption, and they try to see that, you know, to make sure that one group is not all boozing it up and the other ones, you know, are all prim and proper and teetotalers. You know, they want to make sure that they control for those factors and then see what's happening in terms of the long-term outcomes for these people. Okay? All right. So, all right. There are difficulties because, you know, usually you have like this large study, but the vegan group is still pretty small. So they don't get quite as many vegans as we would like. There are enough to study, but, that's a hard group to study because, and small variations in that population may make a difference sometimes. So there are, and sometimes there's other confounding factors like B12 and whatnot. Okay, so as I said, don't just believe me. Look up, that's the website we can download my references, but the better thing is just the YouTube and then download my references from there. So let's talk about the five big problems that humans face in terms of their health, that there's a lot of there's significant evidence that plant-based diet makes a difference. Okay, now some of these things are stronger evidence and some of them are less evidence, but heart disease, stroke, cancers, okay, and we talk about cancer, we talk about the total amount of cancers that people get and die from, as well as specific cancers, obesity, diabetes, okay. There's other things that we like to talk about as well, dementia, we talked about that in a previous talk, constipation, diverticulitis, gallstones, autoimmune diseases, and some other things, okay. So let's talk about this. First of all, total and all-cause mortality, 1999, associations between diet and cancer, ischemic heart disease, and all-cause mortality in non-Hispanic white California Seventh-day Adventists. Very long title. You got to be kind of a nerd like me to be able to go through and read these things. But 34,000 people followed for 12 years, Seventh-day Adventists, you know, controlled for those different factors I talked about, and they found that in terms of death from heart disease, there was 37% less in the vegetarian group, 88% less colon cancer, 54% less prostate cancer, and there's some benefit of other cancers as well. And the vegans lived longer, okay? And now they lived in, men lived about 3.2 years longer, women 2.5 years longer. Doesn't sound like a lot, but it's a lot when you, for medicine, for a doctor, that's enough to get excited. Because, you know, I prescribe all kinds of medications, blood pressure medications, diabetes medications, and I have to prescribe, like, you know, the number needed to treat, I have to treat 20 people for one person to live 1 year longer. You know, those are the numbers. And we consider, like, if I can have somebody live, you know, longer for 1 year for $100,000, if I give, like, 20 people medications for 5 years, it'll add up to, let's say, $100,000. And one person lives 1 year longer, that's considered cost effective, okay, for all these people to get medication. So the fact that you can have people for no extra cost at all, no intervention at all in terms of medical intervention, living that much longer, that's a big deal. Now, also in this study with the Seventh-day Adventists, the meat-eating group wasn't eating a lot of meat. So that's an interesting thing. Because if you look at somebody who's smoking and they just smoke one cigarette per week, right, and compare them to non-smokers, you're not going to find much of a difference. a cigarette would have to be pretty darn bad if you're going to be able to find a difference. It has to be really bad for you to be able to find a difference, you know. So the fact, you know, and usually you can't find a difference. You have to, you really, what you want to do is you want to find people who are smoking a pack a day, compare them to non-smokers, and then you're going to see a difference after some time for disease and mortality. But even though the meat-eating group ate less than half the amount of meat than the average American, they still managed to find a difference. And they found in this population of Seventh-day Adventists, because the people were, you know, the meat-eating group was eating low meat, and then there's other people who are vegetarian and having very little animal protein. Overall, these guys lived almost 10 years longer than the average American population. So that was a very interesting study. This Adventist 1 group didn't have vegans as a subgroup in there, but the Adventist 2 group does have vegans as a subgroup. Okay, and so what they found in this subgroup, which in this paper came out studying 73,000 people, there's about 4,000, nearly 5,000 vegans in that group, and they found that there's 15% less death over the 5 years, that 5-6 years that they studied this group. But that study is ongoing, and eventually they're going to get 10-year, 15-year, 20-year data, and then you'll see the spread, if there is a spread, if there's an advantage for vegans, you'll see that getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Okay, so these are some of the types of data that we have. It's not like we have a slam dunk, like 10 papers all showing that vegans live longer. We have some papers showing that, we have many papers showing that vegetarians live longer, very strongly showing that. But then in terms of the vegan subgroup, we have some data suggesting that they get less heart disease and so forth, but we have to wait for more data to really see that proof come stronger. Anybody heard of the China study? Okay, China study is an interesting study. There's a book about it that's really quite famous. Okay, and it's a great study in some sense that they have like these, they have about 6,500 people, and in 50 counties maybe, like there's like a, like over 100 villages that they studied. And people are genetically and their lifestyles are very similar, but there was just varying amounts of animal protein. And they saw that this incremental increase in animal protein had incremental effects on diabetes, heart disease, and mortality. Okay, now these are people living in rural China, so it may not necessarily always apply to everything that we do here, but it's still a very good study and a very good indication that plant-based diet is good, but you can't just hang your hat on one single study, all right? So a lot of people watch, you know, read the book and China study and they're convinced. What I like to do is say, hey, since then we've got a lot more papers, again, showing that plant-based diet is good for you. Cardiovascular disease. And this is the article where the China study comes from, published in 1998. And so, you know, there was like, you know, 16 times lower heart disease in males, 5 times lower than in females compared to, you know, people in the United States. But, and they found that, you know, increased amounts of vegetables, greens, low salt, more lentils, and less meat, you know, each of those things caused incremental advantages. Again, we shouldn't necessarily compare them to people in the US, we should just compare them to each other, actually. All right, and they did have advantages. 1990. Dean Ornish. Anybody heard of Dean Ornish? He did this study where there was he had like 58 people and they had advanced heart disease, bad angina, but they were not willing to get surgery or they're not candidates for surgery for whatever reason. They all did angiograms showing these sort of, you know, blockages in the coronary arteries. He put them on like he put like 28 of them on a vegan, plant-based, you know, low-fat, whole food plant-based diet. So very specific, low-fat, whole food, plant-based, very low-fat. They weren't even allowed to eat olives because there was like too much fat in an olive. Okay, so they're almost on like a zero-fat diet, okay? And whole food, plant-based. And he got them to exercise, do yoga, and all these things. Both groups, they got them to stop smoking. The second group was just given regular standard diet advice that is given by American cardiologists and just to follow that, okay? And what they found over, after 1 year, is that after 1 year, they found that when they did a repeat angiogram, they found that there was reversal of heart disease in the people that were on the low-fat, plant-based diet as well. So that's one of the diseases that not just any vegan diet, but a very specific diet has been shown to solve. Now, maybe other vegan diets can do the same thing. We don't know the data yet, though. But, you know, if you're really super low-fat, whole food, plant-based, then you can reverse lesions in the heart. Now, that doesn't mean 100% lesions. Those that have calcium buildup cannot be reversed, but they're also the ones that are not as dangerous as well. Now, Caldwell Esselstyn did the same study on a larger number of people and found that he didn't do the exercise and yoga and stress management, just did the diet thing, the low-fat, whole-food, plant-based diet versus standard, you know, and some groups didn't follow it. And in his group that really followed that strictly, over a couple of years, you know, maybe 2 or 3 years, basically nobody had, like only one person person had like basically a heart attack or something like that, and everybody else had no more events. Whereas in like the 20 or 30 people that stopped following the diet, 60% of them had a repeat heart attack, died of a heart attack, or had to have a cardiac surgery or something like that. So a very drastic difference, and it shows that just the vegan diet alone, but a really specific type of vegan diet did reverse that. And diabetes, you can reverse a lot of diabetes like that too. Maybe not 100%, but we'll talk about some slides with diabetes, okay? So cardiovascular disease, another one from the Epic Oxford here, showing that, you know, vegetarians had a 32% lower heart disease. Now this study did not separate for vegans, it just looked at vegetarians as a whole and meat eaters as a whole, okay? And so the vegans were lumped in with the other vegetarians. But in some of the studies that are, you know, it does show like more of an advantage for vegans. But again, there's like these mixed group of studies. All right. Now the thing is also in these studies, it's hard to distinguish. A lot of the people, you know, fish has always said if you eat fish, it's good for you, right? Anybody heard that? Fish is good for you. Okay. So like I'll talk more about omega-3s. But in these studies, you know, you have to see what people are comparing each other to. So if you take a standard meat eating diet, most of the time it's not very healthy. And if you get them to eat fish instead of eating the meat, then maybe compared to meat, fish is healthy. But does that mean that fish is really healthy? Does that mean it's the best thing? It's just healthy in that study compared to eating other forms of meat. That's what you can conclude. It doesn't mean that it's the best thing. All right, yep. What's that? Omega-3, so I'm gonna talk more about omega-3s, okay? What's that? We'll talk about that. I'll talk about omega-3s. I'll talk about that. I'm going to have slides about that. So anyways, what it shows is that, you know, so when you're doing these studies, here's the thing. In the EPIC study, all it does is if somebody doesn't eat meat and they do eat fish, right, then they're called a fish eater in that study, okay? But they may only eat fish. A lot of people who eat fish, they don't eat fish every single day. They eat fish once in a while, right? And for the most part, they're vegetarian, except that sometimes they eat fish. That's how the eating pattern of most people who eat fish. Fish is kind of more expensive, it's kind of fancy. You don't eat it every day like your bacon and eggs, which people kind of eat more than every day. So a lot of times it's hard to tell that difference. It's like, you know, when fish looks good, maybe is it the fish that's good, or is it the fact that they're actually mostly vegetarian, okay? Other vascular diseases besides heart disease. When your heart is affected, all of your arteries are affected. The arteries in your brain are narrowing, your legs, your arms. People have peripheral vascular disease in their legs. They get diabetic foot ulcers. They get, you know, erectile dysfunction, unfortunately, you know, or fortunately, depending on the relationship. I don't know. You know, and so forth, right? So people get all kinds of blood vessel improvements. There hasn't been a study on erectile dysfunction, but you hear it a lot of times that somebody, you know, who had erectile dysfunction, you went on this low-fat, whole food, plant-based diet and actually reversed it, right? And stroke, there's some data on stroke. Strokes are less common, so they're harder to study to get statistical significance, but there's a few studies that show that stroke has some benefit. You know, less strokes for people who are more plant-based. Okay, so general combined morbidity and mortality. This study over here, cardiovascular disease, mortality, and cancer incidence in vegetarians, meta-analysis, systemic review. All right. Vegetarians had 29% lower heart disease, 18% less cancer than non-vegetarians. So you can see that being vegetarian doesn't cure you of cancer, doesn't stop you from having any kind of cancer, but you have a lower percentage of cancer. Now, 18% may not sound so fantastic. There's other studies that more later data from the Epic Oxford data showed that vegans had about 20% less cancer compared to like other forms of vegetarians, semi-vegetarians, you know, lacto and pesco people compared to, they had intermediate advantage and the standard diet had the least advantage. So there's one big study where vegans are coming out ahead. But again, like to see what happens with more time, okay? So cancer, let's talk about cancer. Cancer is one of the worst diseases. You know, dying of a heart attack is tragic. You know, maybe not if you're really old and you had a good life. But cancer always sucks because people go through this long, drawn out, devastating process. It's very painful for everybody, especially the patient. And okay, so this Adventist 2 study, you know, just following people after four years, 69,000 people, and they found that that, you know, the vegans had about 16% less cancer, and certain cancers were less, female-specific cancers, and cancers of the GI tract, like colon cancer and stomach cancer, were less, okay? another study, 2014 cell and metabolism. They found that low protein intake is associated with a major reduction in IGF-1 cancer overall mortality in 65 and younger but not older population. 6,000 people studied. And what they found was that people who were ingesting a lot of animal protein had quite a higher mortality than those who were plant-based. Okay, so that was a big deal. But if they had a high protein diet, like a paleo type diet, but all their protein was from plants, in that group of people, there was no disadvantage. It was the animal protein that was hurting people, and the plant protein was safe. Now that doesn't mean it's always safe. I think we have to be careful about having too much protein, because these studies suggest that, you know, these studies, there's a few studies that have come out showing that high protein diet, more cancer, more death. And usually, in almost all those studies, they always say, well, there was a vegetarian subgroup, they didn't die as much, or they actually did better, right? So their vegan subgroup did better, and the other guys did worse compared to the average person, okay? But still, you have to be a little bit careful about overdoing it with the protein, right? Because we need a certain amount of protein, and if you're an athlete or have higher protein needs for some reason, yes, then get more. But we don't always have to overdo it and be protein obsessed. And we're going to talk about more protein needs in a sec. Now, if you're older, for the people who are elderly, over 65, your protein needs go up. So for people who are older than 65, probably you've already bypassed your cancer risk. If you're going to get cancer, you've already gotten it by that time in most cases. But for overall, your protein needs go up. So for elderly people, they may need to. You got to make sure they get their protein. And it doesn't mean they need extraordinary amounts of protein, but a gram per kilogram per day is the amount of protein that they should at least be getting. Okay. Breast cancer. So there's various studies showing that meat increases the risk of breast cancer, processed meat and red meat being worse than others. Okay. Is soy dangerous for the breast? Does anybody hear that soy has estrogen? Who has heard that soy has estrogen in it? Who has not heard that soy has estrogen? Tell me, show me. You've not heard that? Never heard that soy? Okay, because it's a big thing on the internet. It's all over the place. That soy. It's got estrogen. If you're a guy, you're gonna grow boobs. You know, you're not gonna be able to be good in the bedroom. And women, you know, you're gonna get too much estrogen. You're gonna get breast cancer. You're gonna get some other kind of cancer. So soy is one of the most studied foods in the world. They've studied soy. There's so many studies about soy. Now, the studies that show that soy is bad for you were done on mice. You know those mice that are naked, they have no hair? Has anybody seen that on the internet or anything like that? Okay, so they're athymic nude mice. And so these are mice that are bred to be genetically identical. They have no hair, but they also have no thymus. The thymus is a gland that is over here, especially in children. And your immune system, all your white blood cells, develop from the thymus. So they've bred these mice to have no thymus. They've knocked out those genes. And they have zero immune system, okay? Now, if I put something from another person, if I transplant a kidney to me, and it's not like a genetic match to me, my body will reject that kidney. If it's from another species, my body will really totally reject that kidney. So if you want to study, like, for example, if you want to take mice and study breast cancer, you have to take away their immune system, then you can inject them with human breast cancer cells, let's say, and those cells will multiply, and they don't have an immune system that will fight and destroy those breast cancer cells. So that's what they use animals like these mice with no immune system to study. So what they did was they took a bunch of mice and injected them with breast cancer cells from a human and then gave them isoflavones. Isoflavones have this sort of partial, slight, minimal estrogen effect, and they're responsible for why we call soy having estrogen. And they gave them so much of this stuff that it would be like us drinking like, you know, 20 boxes of soy milk every day to be able to get that much of the isoflavones. And they found that the ones that were given the isoflavones, they died more from the breast cancer. Now, what relevance does this study done in the 1980s have on humans today? And it's pretty much zero. Because what we really need to do is, okay, we need to verify what happens if humans eat soy. This may suggest something, but it doesn't tell us the whole story, okay? And what they do, when they find out that, you know, okay, first of all, there's many factors affecting breast cancer, like your age, you know, family history, age of first pregnancy, breastfeeding history, smoking history, saturated fat intake, and all these kind of things. All these kind of things affect, like, your risk for breast cancer, okay? So, now what they found is when they did studies on humans, looking at how much soy people took, right, and they did studies showing, like, what they found was basically that in the Asian studies, not the Western studies, the Asian studies, women who consumed the most soy had the least amount of death from breast cancer and least amount of breast cancer. Now, the Western studies, what they found is basically people ate very little soy. But in the Asian studies, people traditionally eat a lot of soy. So people are having two, three, four servings a day. So this is one of those things where they say, you know, everything in moderation. doesn't work. The people who are having a small amount of soy, there's no harm, there's no benefit really. But for those who are having a large amount, like 3 or 4 servings a day, they're the ones who got the benefit. Okay, so to have that benefit of soy in breast cancer, according to the studies that we have so far, you know, for breast cancer prevention, it's the ones that have a significant amount of soy, similar to the way the Asians are consuming, some of these Asian people are consuming. Okay, and that's that. So what about if you've had breast cancer? People are paranoid that, okay, what if you have breast cancer and you eat this food that has isoflavones, which has this kind of little soy, this estrogen effect, okay? Could it make the breast cancer worse? So there's a few studies with smaller numbers of people. Like, for example, this one was in the, it was JAMA, Journal of the American Medical Association, 5,000 breast cancer survivors, followed for 4 years. And what they found is that those eating the most soy had 30% less death and 30% less recurrence of breast cancer compared to those who didn't, you know, didn't consume soy, and estrogen receptor positive and negative, survivors benefited. Now, there's a few other studies like this, but they're small studies, ranging from like 1,500 to 5,000 women. There's about 4 or 5 studies, each showing the same thing, that the ones who consumed soy had less recurrence. Now, there's not enough of these studies for me to say as a doctor that I trust this 100%. If you've got breast cancer, you better eat soy. When I see another 5 studies or 10 studies and the numbers come up to like 100,000 women, then I'll start saying that to women, right? But this is very suggestive that soy is safe and possibly, quite possibly beneficial, yes? Okay, they don't. So this is soy that's mainly available in the market. This is all GMO soy with the standard pesticides and all that stuff. All the soy studies are with regular soy in the market. It's GMO, it's with pesticides, all right? No, none of these are done with organic soy, all right? Now, maybe some of these women had organic soy, but most of them just had regular soy available in the market, all right? So breast cancer recurrence, you know, there's more articles about that, you know, and soy seems to be protective. Let's go to prostate cancer. So breast cancer is the number one killer in women. Prostate cancer is the number one cancer killer in men. All right. I think smoking is starting to take over again for women. Soy consumption, prostate cancer risk in men, a revisit of meta-analysis of 2009 metadata, American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, 15 studies, they took the data, and they found that, the Asian people in Asia, compared to, had 50% less prostate cancer if they ate more soy. Western studies didn't show any harm, didn't show any benefit. Again, the Western people had very small amounts of soy. The Eastern people had large amounts of soy. And the ones who had the large amounts of soy, 3-4 servings a day, 2-3-4 servings a day, they are the one that benefited. Prostate cancer is terrible, right? And so if we get more data like this, more studies showing the same thing, then again, soy is looking very good. Now, soy is, again, one of the most studied foods. They didn't study mung beans or kidney beans. Maybe you would get the same benefit from these things, but we just don't know that as of yet. Okay, other things about prostate cancer, eggs, red meat, poultry intake, and the risk of lethal prostate cancer, 2012 study, shows that eggs have the most increase in prostate cancer death. Eggs are deadly for prostate cancer. That's showing a lot. I did another study on a talk on diabetes. Again, eggs are very, very bad for diabetes. The Egg Marketing Board in Canada, US, tries to create their own studies, fund their own research, and manipulate older research trying to show that eggs are harmless, but they exclude the diabetics, and they do all kinds of things. If anybody became diabetic, they exclude you from the study and stuff like that, and they use small studies, short duration, that shows the eggs are okay. But again, you have to look at the study and how the study was done, what they included and excluded to see what the, you know, if the conclusions are really good or not, okay? Whole milk, okay? Those in the 21,000 men, 28 years follow-up, published 2010, whole milk is associated with prostate cancer mortality in US male physicians. It was a physician's health study. They found that people drinking whole milk had 50% more cancer, okay? And more than 2 times the death, okay? Now, low-fat milk had a lesser effect, but still increased mortality and morbidity. So another, thing about prostate cancer. So dairy eggs, seem to be making it worse, and soy seems to be making it better, all right? And there's some studies on plant diet showing some benefit in soy, but in prostate cancer, but really the bulk of the data, the strongest data we have just comes from actually soy intake. The people were not necessarily vegetarian or vegan, but they just had more soy intake. Okay, now why is the soy beneficial? Is it because if you're eating a lot of tofu, that means you're eating less meat? Is it this less meat that's that's soy is less harmful, or is the soy that's actually beneficial? My guess is that it's kind of a bit of both, right? But again, the study won't give us that exact answer. But my guess is that the soy is good for you, and at the same time, probably if they're eating a lot of soy, they're having less milk and less animal products. Okay, colon cancer. All right, vegetarian diets and the incidence of cancer in a low-risk population, Adventist 2, you know, showed that there was basically, you know, somewhat less colon cancer in the vegan group, less GI cancers, about 24% less. And then the first Adventist study, there was a dramatic decrease in colon cancer. There's other studies that don't show so much benefit. But again, you got to look at how long they were vegetarian, what was happening in the two groups, and so forth. But overall, there's some, you know, studies, and there's other studies just showing lentils are better. It's not necessarily, they weren't showing, comparing necessarily vegetarians, but those eating more lentils had protection, and definitely those eating more red meat and whatnot and processed meat was bad. Other cancers, pancreatic cancer, there's a few studies again showing that red meat, processed meat is bad, legumes are good, okay? Again, why is fish not shown as bad? Maybe they're just eating less of the meat because they just don't eat so much fish. Fish eaters just eat less, okay? Great, there's a great diabetic study showing that it's not comparing vegetarians in that study, but it's comparing people who eat fish 5 times a week compared to eating fish only 1 time per week, okay, or less, all right, less than 1 time a week. And in that study, it shows that the people who are eating heavy amounts of fish had more diabetes. Now, other studies show that fish is beneficial for diabetes, but the thing is it the fish or is it the fact that they're eating less meat? And in this study where they were actually quantifying the fish, those other studies don't quantify the fish, where they're quantifying the fish, they found that the fish was worse for diabetes. Now, again, in these studies, we don't always know that. Like, but in the, as I mentioned, there's that epic Oxford study where there's less overall cancers in vegans compared to fish eaters and regular and lacto-ovo vegetarians. Gastric cancer, again, some benefit in type 2 diabetes. Diabetes is, again, so heart disease you can reverse. Vascular disease can be reversed to a certain extent. You can't fully reverse it, but a lot of it can be, you know, be stopped, maybe a partially reversed, and you get a lot of protection from it. Diabetes is the same. We did a talk earlier on diabetes, that plant-based diet, vegan diet, you know, is very, very good data that vegan diet is excellent to protect you from getting diabetes, if you don't have diabetes, to stop you from getting it in the first place, and then from protecting you if you have diabetes to, like, reduce the diabetes and get less heart attacks and get less mortality for those people who already suffer from diabetes, okay? Really important disease. You know, something like 10 million, Peter Gleave is here somewhere, he was saying there's 10 million people in the United Kingdom who have diabetes. In the US and Canada, it's awful. There's 10% of the population has it. 50% of the people who are older than 65 have diabetes or pre-diabetes, and people over 20, like 37% have pre-diabetes or diabetes. It's a huge thing, very annoying, a lot of bad complications, okay? Again, there was, more good studies from the U.S., the Adventist group of studies showing that 50%, you know, 50% less diabetes in those who were plant-based, okay? And there's incremental benefits. That's the other thing, there's incremental benefits. You know, the more incremental you are, the incremental, if you're, you know, if somebody has low meat, even if they're not vegan, they still get partial benefits. And if somebody eats only fish, right, is it the fact that fish is good? It's more likely actually the fact that they're mostly vegetarian, but we don't know the exact answer. You know, they get partial benefits, and then the people who are lacto-ovo-vegetarian, they get partial benefits, and the vegans get the most benefit. But again, as a vegan, if you're eating a lot of junk food and this and that and Coca-Cola and white bread and refined carbs, those things are not good for you. All right, obesity. Okay, again, when they do studies in the compare the different groups, the veg, the vegan to the veg to the fish to the semi-veg to the meat eater, you know, the vegans have the best body mass index. Okay, and that's important because body mass index is independently linked to heart disease, diabetes, cancer, and things like that as well. So careful. Just because you're vegan doesn't mean that your food is automatically super healthy, right? You could be eating a lot of junk food. You can be eating potato chips and Coca-Cola. And does anybody know jalebi? It's an Indian sweet. Jalebi. I mean, there's these Indian sweets that even if you look at them, you can get diabetes, right? They're like really bad. Okay, so like we gotta stay away and watch those things. Like they're pretty bad. Okay, and you know I have friends who are vegan who are, you know, very 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 obese or overweight, you know, because they're obviously eating too much of certain things. Okay, and it could even be the right food. Okay, so I work in India every year, and I work in these villages, and I have these farmers who are like these people who are shorter than me and they're skinnier than me, and they can eat like 15 rotis in a day. you know, and they put lots of butter on those rotis as well. And they're still skinny people. Why? Because they're working in the field all day, carrying stuff, whatever, you know. And then there's other people, you know, you have in the city in India, they're eating like two rotis a day and they're like really big, right? We have different amounts of exercise. We burn different amounts of calories, right? So grains and breads, what they say are bad for you, and they say they make you fat. Well, no, it just depends on how much you eat, right? So you have to eat an amount that's, you know, compatible with the amount of calories that you burn. That's simply what it really is, okay? There's lots of evidence, you know, there's a few good studies showing that, you know, people who are, you know, switched to a low meat or a plant-based diet, you know, have improvements in their body mass index and in their weight, okay? And this is not to make anybody, you know, feel embarrassed about weight or, you know, you don't want to do this for self-esteem issues. You want to do it for your health, you know? Because a lot of times there's, you know, people are not nice to people who are overweight and they say mean things and it's not good. It's shown to be discriminatory and emotionally harmful, right? So it's really just talking about health, okay? And that's important. Okay, so let's go. Blood pressure, again, studies showing that people who have more of a plant-based diet have improved blood pressure. Dementia, there's not a lot of direct evidence that people who have, like, dementia is one of those worst diseases. It's like cancer. When people lose their mental abilities in their older age and become, you know, having progressive dementia, it's a really tragic thing. And eventually, people lose their independence, they lose their joy in life, they can't even recognize the people around them eventually. And it's a terrible state to actually be in. It's kind of almost living death sometimes. I deal with a lot of this. And people who have more diabetes, more overweight, higher cholesterol, and have higher animal protein at certain points of their life, have higher rates of dementia later on. But we don't have direct evidence that vegetarians following them for 20 years have less dementia than their meat-eating counterparts. That's more the direct evidence. I'm waiting for those kind of studies to come, but we have indirect evidence right now that this can possibly be good for you. And of course, part of dementia is blood vessel disease that goes to the brain, where the arteries get narrow and people get tiny, tiny strokes and little parts of the brain die like Swiss cheese, okay? And so presumably, if you're having a really good plant-based diet, not the junk food plant-based diet, you can prevent that, okay? So these are some of the studies talking about midlife cholesterol predicts later onset risk of dementia and so forth. And there's diabetes and stuff like that. Other issues like thyroid, you know, people get like low thyroid. They say that soy is bad for thyroid because of some test tube experiment done in the 80s or 70s. But actually, the evidence shows that people consuming more soy and who are vegan have slightly less thyroid disease. Okay. Now, maybe it's just delaying the inevitable because it's so common, but there is a benefit. And diverticulitis. Diverticulitis is when the colon gets all yucky and old and thin, and you get little pockets and little holes in the colon and whatnot. And then people get that get infected. It's a common disease. You might not have heard of it, but it's a colon thing, you know, and people who are plant-based have less diverticulitis. Okay, so that's a lot of that's a summary of the medical evidence from medical papers that shows that we can, you know, the diseases that can be improved or likely improved or possibly improved by some extent by a plant-based diet. Is veganism always superior to every other form of diet? We don't have exactly every single paper. We don't have a paper where there was a, you know, 10,000 vegans from birth and we watch them for 100 years to see, you know, and compared to other people and we watch them forever. We don't have those kind of studies. But from the studies that we do have, it shows that it's at least as healthy as the other diets that we have available and possibly more healthy, okay? And we're waiting for more diet data to come out from the Oxford, Epic Oxford study and the Adventist study and more and bigger studies will come forward as well. But there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of things to suggest that vegan diet is likely going to outdo the other forms of diet, and that the other forms of diet. Well, there's a good study called the PREDIMED study where they took all these people on Mediterranean diet. So Mediterranean diet, you know, what do you think of when you hear about Mediterranean diet? What's the one thing you think of? Olive oil. Okay. So in America and Canada, when they hear about Mediterranean diet, the first thing they think of is fish. They say, oh, Mediterranean diet's better. I got to eat more fish, right? But when they actually looked at people in a Mediterranean diet and they thought, okay, well, what components, okay, look to who's benefiting and what are they eating? Which components are shown to be beneficial? They found that fish, in a couple of studies where they analyzed the subgroups of the Mediterranean diet, they found that fish wasn't so helpful, but olive oil was helpful, whole grains were helpful, and peanuts, those eating peanuts and nuts were helpful, And so those are the factors that turned out to be much more beneficial than the fish itself. And the fish didn't really statistically seem to have a benefit. Again, those are one or two studies. Let's see what more studies of the same show, because I don't want to just say that that proves that fish are inferior, but it's looking that way so far, okay? All right, so what are the four vegan food groups? What are the four vegan food groups?
Vegetables,
fruits, pulses, grains, right? So, and then there's nuts and seeds, which kind of fit into more than one group, or you can say it's a fifth group, which makes it more difficult, because I don't know about here, but in Canada, we always have four food groups, right? So it's hard, you know, but nuts and grain, you know, nuts and seeds also are kind of a food group. And then some things like oils and sugars, you know, those are things that we, you know, questionable benefit. We maybe don't want to eat too many of those, but there is some evidence showing that olive oil may be good for you. And, you know, some of the polyunsaturated oils like canola oil can be good for you, soybean oil, you know. So the four major food groups. And what I tell people is, what do you eat? You want to eat from all four food groups. There's a lot of people who become veg or vegan, like, you know, they become vegan and they're not eating enough of all the things. They're eating too much junk food. They're eating all pasta. They're eating all white bread or something crazy like that. You know, they're getting all these processed foods, you know, buying frozen dinners or something like that because they don't have time to cook and they don't know how to cook and they don't want to learn. You know, so that's not going to be healthy for you. You want to eat whole foods. The benefit is from whole foods. And some things are almost whole foods. Like if you get soy milk, it's almost a whole food. Okay, just because it's somewhat processed doesn't mean it's always bad. You have to see what the process is. Processed foods add certain things like salt and sugar. Those are no good. And they take away certain things like fiber and other nutrients. So if they're taking away too much and adding too much of the bad stuff, then okay, maybe that processed food is not good. But things like soy milk, even if they contain a little bit of carrageenan in or whatever it is, generally are really pretty good for you. Okay, and they're not super processed. But mostly try to go for more whole foods. Don't eat white rice, let's eat the brown rice. Let's eat quinoa, let's eat whole veggies, let's eat beans and pulses and all those kind of things. Let's go for the whole foods, all right? And avoid things like fruit juices. Juice is not a whole food. If you drink apple juice, orange juice, has the same amount of sugar as Coca-Cola, okay? And eating too much sugar is bad, okay? I wanna say that that's bad. You know, just because it's vegan, if it's like white noodles or sugar or too much oil or something like that, it's not good for you, yes?
Just while we're on sugar.
Yeah. Yep, there's okay, so agave syrup has it, because the type of sugar in agave, it's not like sucrose, it's a different sugar, and it doesn't show up on your diabetes test so easily, okay? So the test looks good, so people say agave is good, but it's actually not. In your body, it acts just like sugar, but it's just not easily detected on the test, okay? So all those sugars, if it's a sugar, it's not good for you. A little bit, you don't have to completely ban yourself from sugar, you know, but like just moderation, yes? Right, so, you know, I don't have enough data on that. People say, some people think they're like the devil, but I don't think there's any evidence that really shows that they're horrible for you. They're probably better than eating sugar. If you can eat a lot of sugar, then probably eat that stuff instead. If you're gonna have a Coke, have a Diet Coke instead of a regular Coke. However, you can also just drink water. Okay, and that's probably even better for you, right? Now, once in a while, if you have a Coca-Cola, diet or not diet, that's okay, all right? If your diabetes, okay, drink the Diet Coke. But, you know, if you're drinking Coke every day, that's bad for you, it doesn't matter which one you take, all right? So, maple syrup. Yeah, I just brought my friend a big maple syrup, and she was joking with me. She says, you just gave a talk on diabetes, and you bought me a big thing of maple syrup. I said, that's right. Just don't eat it all at once, right? So a little bit of sugar. Now, some people, see, this is what happens. Some people get into a really super strict, you know, vegan diet. They hear this thing like, oh, Dean Ornish, super low-fat, plant-based diet, and they do that. They do that for a couple of years, and eventually they stop being vegan because they lost too much weight, they got too much skinny, and they're not enjoying their food. So, like, vegan, have a healthy, whole food, plant-based diet that's lowish in fat, but then there's still variations, okay? You can allow yourself a little bit of sugar here and there, a little bit of salt here and there, you know? Have a treat here and there, okay? Just don't go crazy, right? And some people, if they're really trying to reverse their heart disease, may be going really low fat, but if you're finding yourself too skinny, then, hey, put a little bit of olive oil, canola oil in your diet in a rational way, and maybe that's all right. You can have a bit more protein. The veggie hot dogs, you know, those veggie meats, those mock meats? Like, they're not for everybody, but for some people who are used to those kind of foods and they're switching from eating meat, those things are definitely better than eating meat, so allow yourself to have some of that. A lot of the ones that we have, like, we have this one called tofurkey in Canada and US, okay? I don't know if you get tofurkey here? Yeah? The tofurkey sausages, though I like those because they're organic, number one. Number two, they have the amount of sodium they have is high, but it's less than. But if you compare that to the meat sausage, it's half the sodium of a meat sausage of the same size. They have double the protein of an equal-sized meat sausage, and about about half the fat of an equal-sized meat sausage. Okay, so overall, maybe it's not the best as good as eating your beans or all those kind of things, but it's still a lot better than eating meat. And if that's going to be easier for you, and I make that for my friends who eat meat, I know how to good recipes. I can use those, chop them up, and saute them, and serve them to my friends who are meat eaters, and they love it. And I know that this is going to be healthier for them, and maybe they're going to start considering, hey, I can do this veggie thing partially and maybe even fully. Like a lot of my friends, over time, they become veggie, so it's good, right? So humans evolved from herbivores. I don't want to go into this too much, but there's a lot of things about humans that we are really designed as herbivores. And when people say we're omnivore, we are not an omnivore. I completely disregard that term. We're not omnivore. Have you ever seen a dog? A dog's an omnivore. Have you ever seen a dog eat a pigeon or a bird, attack a pigeon or a bird? I've seen it, unfortunately. It's not really, really pretty, but I've seen in India a dog eats a pigeon, small dog. Eats the pigeon, eats the whole damn pigeon. I don't know how a small dog eats a whole pigeon. Bites off the wing, and then later on just swallows the wing as well. It ate the feathers, they ate the feet, they ate the head, they ate the blood, they ate the poop, the whole thing. If we did that, we'd be sick. We are not omnivores, we are technivores. Humans, at some few thousand years ago, started eating meat when we developed the technology to be able to capture an animal, because naturally we can't capture a pigeon. We're not good enough to do that. We have technology to do that. And we developed fire. And we separated certain parts of the animal away. We took out the feather, we took out the guts, and we cooked the rest of it on a fire. Fire is a very advanced form of technology that animals don't have. Omnivores, a bear doesn't cook its food, okay? It doesn't cook the rabbit or whatever it is. It's able to eat even rotten meat and not get sick. The pH in the stomach is so high, right? And then it eats. We are technivores. That we've learned to eat these things where in the jungle, when we used to live and food was scarce, these were sources of high amounts of protein and calories that we can get all at once, okay? But we had to have technology to do it, so we could be a technivore, but definitely not an omnivore, okay? But now, in this day and age, we have plenty of easy ways to get the amount of protein and calories that we need, and our problem is not dying of starvation, our problem is dying of cancer and diabetes and heart attacks, okay? So, where do I get my protein? So Patrick is over there. I asked him if he was coming to this presentation. I was like, he said, no, I'm too busy because I got my booth. And I'm like, thanks God, because he's going to beat me up when I see this like slide comparing him to a gorilla, right? But anyways, Patrick seems like nicer than the gorilla anyways. This gorilla seems like he's like got a bad attitude. But they get their protein from plants, right? And we are herbivores. So we can do another talk. There's a great talks by... a doctor from the US, he does a great talk on how humans are herbivores. A lot of really good adaptive things that, a lot of biological things. So proteins, beans, lentils, quinoa, sprouted lentils, hemp, these soya things, these veggie meats, soy milk, tempeh, whole grains, oatmeal, rice, all of these things have protein. Okay, grains have 10% protein by mass, beans and lentils have even more, and soy has the most. All we need is 1 gram of protein per kilogram. Most of us need less. We need about between 0.6 and 0.8 grams per kilogram of protein. So it's not a lot of protein. It's easy to get. But just make sure, because some people, I see them becoming vegan, and they just drop all the protein foods, and they don't put in the other foods. So there are some people who don't get enough protein because they're just not thinking about it properly. So if you become vegan, if you're doing it in a rational way, it's easy to get enough protein. I'm always in a hurry. I'm always busy, I never have enough time. So yeah, I have some smoothies and protein shakes as well, just to speed things up for me, because a lot of times I have like 5 minutes to eat and then I gotta run. Not a good habit, but it happens, right? So there's all these, healthy, vegan protein things that you can also do too, all right? But it's not that hard, okay? Elderly people may need more, and lysine is a key amino acid that's a little bit less in the seeds and the grains, but it's high in beans, soy, lentils, hemp, quinoa. So make sure you get some of those, the beans, pulses, and all that kind of stuff, hemp and quinoa as well. Okay, B12. There's no natural source that we can get B12 from. Now, cows and horses and other herbivores, elephants, where do they get their B12? No animal produces B12 in the body, right? If I'm drinking cow's milk, I'm not getting B12 because the cow produced milk in its body. B12 is made by bacteria, okay? And it's found in the ground and in the soil, in the river. In the old days, we used to drink from any river, any pond that we can get water from, and we used to eat stuff from the ground that was full of dirt, and we used to get B12, okay? We don't do that anymore. I don't recommend that you eat dirt, Okay? If you go to your backyard and you put some dirt in the water, shake it up, filter it, drink the water, you'll probably get some B12, but I don't recommend that either. Okay? Just take a supplement. It's easy. All right? You take, and what I recommend to people is take 1,000 microgram supplement or a 500 microgram supplement a couple of times a week. Okay? Now, I drink soy milk that has B12 already in it. It's got like, you only need like 2 micrograms a day, okay? So for most people, that's enough, but some people have an absorption problem for whatever reason. So just to be on the safe side, I tell everybody to take a supplement because I don't know which one's gonna have an absorption problem. Soy milk is great, you can do that. Once a year or every couple of years, maybe every 5 years, just check your B12 with your doctor. And if it's okay, I had my B12 checked like a few years back. It was fine, my diet hasn't changed, so I haven't tested it again. Okay, there's no rule. But if it's low, then just, you know, take some more B12, get it tested again. You do not need injections. Some people, oh, I'm vegetarian, so I get this B12 injection. That annoys me. You don't need an injection just because you're vegetarian or vegan, okay? Just take a supplement. The supplement is easy. They just grow the bacteria in a lab and they filter out the B12, all right? So do that. People think that nutritional yeast has B12 in it. No, it doesn't. Some brands do, just because they add it afterwards, but it's not a reliable source, okay? But when there's added to soy milk and margarine, a few things, that may be good enough, but just get it tested once in a while. And if it's low, then take a supplement. It's cheap and it's easy. That's the only supplement that you need just because you're a vegetarian or vegan.
What about seaweed and some mushrooms?
Okay, seaweed, some mushrooms. Maybe there's some B12. I don't know the evidence, but there's variability and it's not a reliable source. So still, even if you're eating those things, check it once in a while. If you're okay, then, you know, just check it every few years, you know? And even a lot of people who eat meat, I have a lot of patients who eat meat and dairy and all these things, they still have low B12. So B12, low B12. Oh, back again, okay. So it's even common in people who eat meat, they have low B12. So it's just a really common thing. So even they need to take a supplement. But if you're a vegan and if you have low B12, everybody's gonna point the finger at you, oh, you're the vegan, you got low B12. So it's kind of annoying. So just take a B12 supplement and just, you know, make that a non-issue. And there could be some stuff that, you know, there's this, if for people with low B12, you may have some increased risk of cancers and things like that. And that's why some of the studies, you know, show people who have vegans have less, have, you know, they don't have as much cancer benefit as you would expect. Maybe because for a long time, they were not supplementing with B12. Okay, so make sure you get that, all right? And, you know, you can even take a tablet, break it up, and mix it with the family food, you know, because 1,000 micrograms is plenty, all right? You can share with the whole family. All right, if you're pregnant or lactating or, you know, then make sure you're having B12. Breastfeeding women and pregnant women must take their B12. And if you have a vegan baby, they can have fantastic vegan food. Just make sure they're getting B12 somehow in that food, okay, as a toddler, okay? You gotta supplement the B12 for the toddler. Toddlers and pregnant women, 100% can be vegan, and probably in this day and age, we have a lot of childhood obesity. Just make sure they're eating the 4 food groups, make sure they're getting enough protein, make sure they're getting the B12, all right? And that's it, you're good to go. Oh, another thing I forgot to mention about protein. Has anybody heard about complementing your protein? You have to have a grain and a legume together. That's old news, that's historical, that's found to be false. Every single plant food has a complete protein. It's just, as I mentioned, that some grains are lower in lysine, and so like you get a little bit better protein from lentils and all that kind of stuff, but the grain still has a complete protein. It's just lower in one of the amino acids, okay? Calcium and iron, just, you know, do your easy thing to do, go to Google and Google calcium, vegan, or iron, vegan, and you'll get lots of pictures and lists of things that you can have that has iron and calcium in it. It's easy to get the right amount of calcium and the right amount of iron, okay? In fact, there's some evidence that having too much may not be good for you, and a lot of meat eaters may be eating too much and maybe getting some of the diseases partly because of overload of iron. But get enough of these things, check your iron once in a while, especially women, legumes, you know, dark green leafy vegetables, broccoli and stuff like that, you know, prune juice, molasses, cream of wheat, whole grains, raisins, nuts, seeds, other things, they all have iron, they all have calcium, okay? Broccoli and kale are superfoods because they have calcium and iron, but they also have vitamin C. The vitamin C helps you absorb the calcium. Okay, so when you're eating these foods, these lentils and stuff, eat your lentils with tomatoes and squash and anything that's red and orange and stuff like that usually has vitamin C in it. It's not just an orange, but lots of vegetables have vitamin C. Just Google vitamin C, you know, sources, vegan, and you'll see lots of fruits and vegetables. And combine them with your, you know, eat them at the same meal with your lentils and you're going to absorb more of these things. But like I said, broccoli and kale are superfoods. Now, calcium, there's a lot of showing that calcium, extra calcium, doesn't benefit you. Taking calcium supplements doesn't prevent osteoporosis, doesn't prevent fractures. Fractures are more important. The broken bone, fracture means broken bone, and that's more important than just having osteoporosis. You know, really, when somebody breaks their hip or something like that, that's what really counts, okay? And there's a lot of studies now showing that milk, people having more milk, actually have more fractures in their later age. So milk is shown to be associated with more fractures. Vitamin D and calcium supplementation has not been shown to be beneficial. And too much calcium may actually contribute to some heart disease. So now if you're very low and malnourished, then yes, milk is good for you. So for somebody who's malnourished, milk will be good, okay? And hello. Okay, there we go. So soy is shown to be better for your bones. There's good evidence showing that soy, people who have a lot of soy have less fractures in their later age. Soy is a superfood, okay? Less breast cancer, prostate cancer, ovarian cancer, less heart disease, less diabetes, and stronger bones. Okay, there's no single food that has that much positive evidence behind it. And all the people talking about soy and estrogen, it's all bogus. The meat and dairy industry spend millions of dollars, millions of pounds or euros, I guess, over here, you know, on websites and books and authors trying to tell you that soy is bad for you because they see this as a serious competition. And they are actually very successful, okay? But there's not a single study that shows that soy is bad for you that I've seen. And if the soy is GMO, all the studies that show that soy is good for you, it's all GMO soy. It's still good for you and full of pesticides. There's no evidence showing that it's bad. All of the studies on soy show that it's beneficial on humans. The studies were done with GM soy and regular soy in the market. Now, organic soy may be even better. It's possible that organic soy... I'm just talking about the medical paper. The medical papers show benefit in humans. Okay, but we can talk about this later. There's environmental detriment for using GM because of pesticides and things like that. GM is a little bit more complicated than a lot of people think, right? If somebody puts a GM gene in a food that provides drought resistance or adds vitamin C to a food, that may not be bad. But if Monsanto makes a food that is resistant to Roundup, and as a consequence they use more Roundup, that's bad for the environment, for humans, and everybody. So it depends on the genes and it depends on what's going on as to whether GM is bad for you. But the studies on genetically modified soy the studies on soy in humans is done by regular market soy, which is basically GMO pesticide soy. Organic soy may be even better for you, but this food is still good for you as compared to eating meat, that's for sure. Okay, even if it's quote unquote organic meat. Okay, let's talk about iron. For some people, iron may be low. You know, we can just Google the iron foods, take it with vitamin C, and if you need to, take a supplement, okay? Fruits and vegetables are also shown to benefit bones. Eating more legumes causes less fracture risk. Milk, I say there's conflicting evidence, but this is an old slide. Now there's evidence, more and more evidence showing that it actually increases fractures, okay? Vitamin D3, no real evidence of benefit, but if there's an elderly person or a dark-skinned person like myself living in a country where there's less sunlight, then maybe I need to supplement some vitamin D in some of those specific cases. But some early studies showed the vitamin D may be beneficial, but the newer studies show that there's not really much benefit in vitamin D, so the craze, just like omega-3, there was a craze, and then it went down, okay? But just for certain people, like, you know, senior citizens living in the home and never going outside, they may need more calcium, protein, and vitamin D in those specific circumstances. Vitamin C, taking a supplement, is shown to be actually increasing people's mortality on average. Same with vitamin E. The vitamin supplement has not shown benefit, shows a small harm, but eating the food that contains vitamin C is beneficial. So eat food with vitamin C. Don't focus on supplements, focus on eating whole foods, okay? Watch out for the junk foods. We talked about this. Very, very important. Even if you're vegan, this is not good for you. Again, you can eat a little bit here and there, okay? okay? Just judge by your own body mass index, okay? Fruits and veggies versus supplements. Fruits and veggies win every time, supplements lose every single time. Remember that juice is not a whole food. The juice in orange juice or apple juice is the same amount of sugar as Coca-Cola. Don't drink juice, orange juice, eat an orange. Don't drink apple juice, eat an apple, and so forth. But now when you're juicing vegetables, maybe there's some benefits when you're having broccoli and kale and all these vegetables, you make a juice. You know, that may be good for you because it's not full of sugar, okay? But still, doesn't mean you can stop eating the vegetable. The vegetable is still important to eat. Eat still, you should eat the whole food. The whole food is always good. So you can juice, but make sure you're still eating the vegetables, okay? Now, is gluten the devil? Is there a big craze in Europe about gluten-free everything?
Yeah?
Same in North America, okay? All the studies show that people eating whole grains, not refined carbohydrates, whole grains have less diabetes, less mortality, and slightly less cancer, okay? Now, maybe some people have gluten intolerance, but it's interesting. When they do the study on, let's say there's a whole bunch of people, I get 1,000 people, and they all come, 100 people, they come to me and they say, oh, I'm gluten intolerant. I feel bad when I eat gluten. So what I do is I do a study on them. They've done a couple of these studies. And what they do is they find out first who's got celiac disease. Because celiac disease is a very specific type of allergy that some people have to gluten. It's a very, very severe thing. 1% of the population, 0.5% of the population has it. It's more in some places. Like I think in Ireland, it's up to 4%, you know. But most of the world, it's like 0.5% or 1%. One in 100 people. You know, they have a severe allergy to gluten for some reason. Okay, so they've tested everybody for celiac disease, and they get rid of those people out of the study. Now, the rest of the people have non-celiac gluten intolerance. And what they do is they put them on a gluten-free diet, but they give them a muffin to eat. And that muffin is a secret muffin that may contain gluten or placebo. They don't know which muffin they're getting. And they put them on that muffin for, like, let's say 2 weeks, then they stop it for a week, and then they switch the groups around. And they say, hey, which muffin made you feel sick? Was it muffin A or muffin B? And the person doesn't know. And pretty much 47% of them or 45% of them will say, I felt really good on the gluten muffin, and they felt worse on the one that was actually gluten-free. And it's like 47% and 53% or so felt better on the gluten-free muffin. So maybe there's 5% of people who somehow know the difference, or maybe they can just tell the difference between the muffins and it's not really a placebo for them, right? But most people don't know. So this could be a lot of placebo effect. And I know, I grew up in a society where there was a lot of racism. Okay, when I was a kid, people were pretty racist. And I would go to a room and I'd go see people and people would hate me based on my color. It was a gut reaction. An automatic reaction. People get programmed by what? Just by other people talking. And everybody saying it. And all of a sudden it becomes a true, and you feel it. And a lot of discrimination against human beings happens that way. Right? It happens for GBLT, it happens for race, it happens for poverty, it happens for all kinds of reasons. The same thing happens for food. If everybody's saying something, then all of a sudden people believe it. And that's the way marketing and all these kind of things become memes in society. Okay, now, there's a lot of false beliefs in society, many of them harmless, many of them harmful. Okay, but there's actually very little evidence that there's anything about gluten intolerance. And the evidence about whole grains shows they are definitely beneficial for people. A lot of evidence for diabetes, mortality, cancer, heart disease, that whole grains are actually good for you. And indeed, there's evidence that humans have been eating grains for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. Okay, so not that we have to justify something based on paleo diet, but you know, physiologically, I don't see anything wrong with them. Okay, so whole grains definitely give a lot of strength and energy, prevent heart disease, prevent certain types of cancer, and decrease mortality. And soy is safe. Okay, all the studies on humans, they've done study on men, studied on women, they studied on cancer survivors, they studied on children, they've done studies on sperm counts. There's not a single study that shows any kind of harm in soy, yet it's all over the internet. Based on zero studies, or maybe based on the one study that was done on mice in the 80s, okay? And maybe one study done in the 80s in a test tube about some thyroid-related thing. But again, the evidence on soy shows that there's actually slightly less thyroid disease in soy. People eat a lot of soy. So it's safe. And I think soy is a great food, not because you don't have to eat soy, but lentils and legumes in general are ecologically safer. They take less land, water, they fix nitrogen back to the soil. They're good for transition foods for like these veggie hot dogs and things that we eat. They have high protein content, and they definitely strengthen your bones, prevent heart disease, and they actually, have some anti-cancer effects as well. Okay, so that's why I think that soy is a great food. You don't have to eat it, but we shouldn't be afraid of it. And the meat and dairy industry is winning by convincing people that it's bad for you. You know, and they even got doctors and nutritionists and all kinds of saying it, people saying it too, because there becomes a paranoia, just like any type of racism. When there's a society that says something is bad and everybody's saying it, then of course it must be true. And that's true for a lot of tragedies that has happened in the world. Okay, soy versus almond milk. Again, I think that, you know, soy is better. Not that almond milk is bad, but ecologically it's better, and you get more protein, and the evidence for health benefits is very solid in soy groups. Paleo diet. Paleo diet. Has anybody heard of the Atkins diet? The Zone diet? The South Beach diet? The paleo diet? It's all the same thing, rebranded, repackaged, marketed to you by the meat and dairy industry and other organizations that they support. Okay? They secretly, you know, they'll pay them like that. Great studies showing that people, like this one over here, low-carbohydrate diet and all-cause mortality and cause-specific mortality in two cohort studies, 2010, Annals of Internal Medicine, 85,000 women, 44,000 men, followed for like 26 and 20 years, okay, showed that people having a high animal protein had 28% death from cancer, more than the standard group, 14% higher death from cardiovascular disease, okay? And so there was a vegetarian group that was paleo. They had high protein, low carb, and compared to the average group, they had less mortality morbidity, and the other guys who were paleo had more. Okay, so again, that's another nail in the coffin for this, you know, diet that causes more disease. Transition foods versus organic meat. Transition foods are probably a lot better. You know, again, pick the veggie meat that is lower fat and doesn't have as much salt content. Watch out, because some of them do have a high fat content or something like that. Okay. GMO soy, we talked about it. There's, you know, it still shows better in human health compared to eating meat. Okay, but you know, compared to eating meat, but organic soy may still be better, right? And that's why I suggest the tofurkey. In Canada, I drink soy milk. I drink the Silk soy milk. The Silk is organic, and it's better for the environment too. Okay, and so fat, salt, sugar, oil. Be careful. Whole foods are the best. All right. Which fats are the best, okay? You know, canola oil, olive oil are thought to, they're thought to be better, soybean oil, because they have a better profile for omega-3 to omega-6 ratios and all that stuff. I don't know if it really matters, but so far we think that canola, olive, and soybean oil are better as compared to safflower oil or those kind of things. Coconut oil, people think that, you know, and palm oil, people think that they're really good sometimes, but really we don't have the evidence to say so. Coconut oil does contain a lot of saturated fat. Saturated fat is bad for you, but most of the saturated fat studies are done on animal saturated fat. So we don't really know enough about soy oil. When people say it's really good, they're basing it on zero evidence so far. And right now, I just say we'd go for the olive and canola, peanuts, and that kind of stuff, because we do have the evidence that they're actually better for you. Okay? Omega-3s, at one point, we thought they were actually good for you, but the bigger studies have come out and shown that there's no benefit. Except in one case. Omega-3s may be beneficial for the brain of a developing baby. So if you're pregnant or breastfeeding, maybe it's better for the developing brain of the baby. But fish contains a lot of mercury and furans and dioxins and all these kind of things, a lot of toxins. The mercury is shown to have really bad effects on the developing brain. And even the fish with the least amount of amount of mercury still contains a lot of mercury. Right? You may have the best fish, but it's still a lot of mercury. So if you're pregnant or breastfeeding, maybe it's good to take some omega-3. You can get it from flax and that kind of stuff, but maybe the marine omega-3s are better. The long chain ones may be better. But you can get a vegan form that's from algae, and it's grown from algae, and that has zero toxins. So even if you have friends who believe in omega-3, take it from the algae because there's no toxin in it. And that's where the fish get it from. They just get it from the algae anyways. So we're just getting a pure form that does not have any toxins in it. So definitely, you know, for a cardiovascular disease and all that kind of stuff, no evidence, you know, and whatnot. And as I mentioned with the fish, you know, maybe it's less bad than other meat, and so it's shown as beneficial. When you do a study comparing it to other meat, maybe it's shown as good because it's not as bad. But compared to vegan diet, it may not be as good. Definitely, there's a good study in diabetes showing that more fish is bad, okay? And in a lot of the other studies, it's kind of confounded because the fish eaters are not eating a lot of fish, and they're almost vegan anyways. Omega, the toxins are really bad, Okay. Other vegan issues, we talked about it already a little bit. You know, rationalize your diet and your situation. Okay. If you crave a lot of certain things, you stop eating meat, but you really miss meat, and you're just always pressuring yourself to stay vegan for, you know, whatever reason, you know, then that's good. But you know what? You can have some tofurkey. You can have some of that stuff. Cook it up the right way, satisfy that craving, and it's still good for you. For some people, if you're too underweight and you're restricting too much oil, have a bit of olive oil. It's okay. Have a little bit of oil. Just don't eat tons of it. You can have carbs. You know, satisfy yourself in a way that's rational. Look in the mirror. Just check out if you're overweight or not, or if you're underweight. Being underweight is also not good, and you can always change that. If you're an athlete, talk to people like Patrick Baboumian out there. Eat more protein. If you're a bodybuilder or something like that and you have higher protein needs, okay, you can get the vegan protein. And it looks like the evidence suggests that people who have high protein diets may get more cancer, but the plant protein seems safer. But again, don't overdo it unless you are really training for something and you need the extra protein. Otherwise, go for that 0.6 to 0.8 grams or maybe a gram per kilogram, okay? All right, so children, you know, pregnant and children, you know, again, make sure you're getting your protein. You're getting enough protein, make sure you get your B12. Children can easily be vegan. It's fine. Estrogen, there's actually a lot of evidence that meat, dairy, and eggs contain estrogen. A cow is pregnant. When a cow is pregnant, she has a lot of hormones in her body. And some of those hormones go into the milk. And it's normal because those hormones help the baby cow grow bigger. Okay? But when we continue to drink that milk, we are continuing to ingest those hormones. Maybe that's part of the reason why we're getting some extra cancer. There's the fat and all that kind of stuff, the saturated fat, the animal protein, but maybe also the hormones. The cow may be organic, but it's just her natural hormones that come into the milk. Same when we eat a fish or any other animal. If it's a female animal, we're getting the estrogen. And that estrogen is going to affect us because we're eating not just isoflavones from plants are a very, very weak form of estrogen. Isoflavones are a very weak, partial, mild form of estrogen. Hardly has any effect on the human body. But animal estrogen has a direct effect on the human body. So when we eat animals, 50% of the time, more than 50% of the time, we're actually eating a female, okay, and we're getting those hormones. And eggs, also from the chicken, you know, has some hormones from the chicken in the egg. So they're getting. So in the emergency department, I see a lot of guys that have boobs. I see a lot of guys with man boobs. And that's actual boobs, okay? Man boobs, some people are laughing. Yes, it's funny, maybe to you, but I'm not allowed to laugh. I'm the doctor. I can't, like, laugh at the patient, all right? I'll get in trouble. Right, but there's man boobs. It's a real thing. Most guys are not vegans. They're all meat eaters. They eat a lot of meat, dairy, and eggs. They're getting some hormones. The hormones create boobs. Also, if you're overweight, you get some peripheral conversion of testosterone and estrogen. That also has an effect. Okay, but animal foods contain estrogen. Plant foods, soy, estrogen. It's mostly a myth. Okay, it is a myth. Cholesterol saturated fat studies. Again, there's a lot of controversies. Anybody heard of these studies that show that cholesterol is okay, saturated fat is okay? Right, the book that came out, The Big Fat Lie, Nina Tikovits, this annoying woman, and I'd love to just debate her on TV or something like that, you know. And the studies from Siri Torino, another one, Chowdhury, there's another study showing that, you know, cholesterol is okay. But it's like the studies go like this. They have these cross-sectional analyses. Like, there's a lot of problems with those studies, and a lot of people, a lot of cardiologists and doctors have written about them, not because they're vegan, but just because they know the studies are flawed. If you take a study with smokers, for example, like in the old days, and you do a study and somebody's smoking 20 cigarettes, and you compare that, you know, and you compare that with somebody else who's smoking 10 cigarettes a day, okay? And then you follow them for, let's say, a couple of years, or maybe a longer time, okay? And then you look at the study and say, okay, it seems like they have the same amount of heart attacks in both groups, there's no statistically significant difference, and they have the same amount of cancers. And that means smoking is okay, because the people that smoke 20 cigarettes a day, and the guys who smoke 10 cigarettes a day, there was no difference. But you see the problem with that study. They need another group that's smoking zero cigarettes, because maybe that difference isn't going to show a difference. And that's what those studies are like. They're showing people's standard diet compared to people's higher diet, higher fat diets. Okay? And they have some meta-analyses, which are generally good, but you have to look at what studies go into the meta-analyses. And some of the meta-analyses, if you look at the studies that they reference, they actually show that there's subgroups that have problems with the high cholesterol and saturated fat, okay, and various things that are problems with the studies themselves. So but there are those kinds of problems. That's one of the big obvious ones. And they're just comparing people with a high-fat diet to a higher-fat diet. They're comparing American standard diet to people who have, like, even higher-fat American standard diet. It's crazy, right? They're not comparing, there's no vegan subgroup in there, right, to show that what really a zero cholesterol diet will
And so those are the studies, then they publish those studies in good journals, maybe, but then, you know, Nina will write a book about it and say that it's a big fat lie, you gotta start eating butter and meat and cheese and all that kind of stuff. But really, that's gonna cause a lot of people to actually have these diseases that we're trying to prevent, okay? So don't be fooled by these cholesterol studies. A study, you have to look at the details of a study, and that's how you know that it's good, okay? Organic meat, probably no benefit. Farting and flatus, okay, is an issue. Some people say they eat a lot of beans, and all of a sudden they fart all the time. You know, if you're not eating beans, if you start eating beans, you might do that. But if you gradually introduce them, your body will adjust. Okay, are we omnivores and herbivores? We covered that. Superfoods, we covered GMO, we talked about. Meat, vegan versus locavore, okay? Here's an interesting ecological fact. But if you go vegan one day, even if your food is not local, that's the same amount of greenhouse gas that you save by eating local food from a standard diet every single day of the week. Because animal foods have such a big impact on the environment. And as I mentioned, watch the movie Cowspiracy, fantastic movie if you haven't seen it. Okay, it talks about, sort of the, explains the science about why animal agriculture impacts the environment. Okay, so we're gonna talk, there's some stuff, slides here about ecological things, which I wanted to go through, but I think maybe our time is actually way done, actually. Like a half an hour over time, maybe almost, you know? So I think what we can do is, I've gone through a lot of data, but what we can do is maybe we can field a few questions. If you have some time, you want to stick around with a few questions. But otherwise, thank you very much. Oh, the last thing I wanted to mention is just like, mention a thing. A lot of people think you got to eat fish for those omega-3s. Well, there's no benefit, as I mentioned. But the other thing is that fish will be cleared from the oceans by 2050 at current rates of fishing. We're going to kill all the fish in the oceans, pretty much. Like 95% of them will be gone and fished out, okay? Because people think you got to eat fish, but 7 billion people, 8 billion people eating fish. Major food security issues here. And you know, it's the second biggest cause of climate change is animal agriculture, the first biggest cause of species extinction, and the first biggest cause of deforestation worldwide, wetland loss worldwide, and all that stuff, you know? And it basically, you know, to feed animals, you gotta feed them this much food, and then you get this much protein and calories back. Compared to if you're vegan, you just need this much land. Now, if you're an organic vegan, yeah, maybe it takes a bit more land, but it's only like this much more land, okay? That's acceptable. Right, and so you know, being an organic vegan is has benefits, but you know, organic meat instead of taking this much land takes this much land, okay? Because it takes more resources to grow something organic, and that really will destroy everything on the planet. So there's a lot of good data behind it, but Cowspiracy is good, and if you see my thing, you can download the United Nations references and other references to talk about like the impact of animal agriculture, and which eventually ultimately will impact people's health. As well as the planet is destroyed, so will people's health be. And as a doctor, I'm worried about individuals' health, but I'm also worried about population health. So, anyways, thank you very much. Sorry, I've been... No, thank you.